Whole Story Quest Audiobooks presents The Princess and the Orrery by F.D. Lee. Narrated by Eilidh Beaton. Chapter 1. Nighttime. The strange blue-skinned creature was crumpled on the floor, clutching its head, back curled, breath coming in short gasps. It reminded Namer strangely of a horse her father had once ridden too hard. The horse, however, had not emanated a freezing aura so bitter that she had to wrap her hands in her sleeves. "That's it. It can't leave," she asked, her breath clouding.
"Not without my permission."
"Does it? Is it in pain?"
"Not precisely."
Joseph's gloved hands gripped a golden necklace shaped like a snake, with an opening between the head and the tail, so that when worn, the head would sit just above the collarbone.
"From what I understand, they get some enjoyment from the process."
It didn't seem to be enjoying itself. Namer knelt beside it, pulling her jacket closed against the cold. It wasn't what she'd expected. She'd imagined something bigger, stronger. Something marvellous. But it just seemed like a man. A strange man, certainly, but just a man. "Are you sure it's what you think it is?" she asked. Joseph tutted, which turned into a cough. He covered his mouth with his forearm, holding the necklace tight.
"Quite sure. Of course, if you're having doubts, I can find someone else willing to work with me, who'd appreciate what I can offer."
Namer wet her lips, regretting it instantly as the cold bit against the moisture. "No, my lord," she said, not certain of her honesty. "No doubts. I just didn't expect it to react that way. It seems so fragile." She reached out to the creature and her body went rigid. Muscles she didn't know she possessed, cramping as a heavy wave of emotion hit her square in her chest, stealing the air from her lungs and sending her flying backwards, hands at her breasts, clawing desperately at her skin. Memories. Images, smells, senses, feelings, all crammed into her mind. A storm of long-forgotten needs, repressed desires, hidden wants. Everything she had ever put aside or grown out of, everything she had dismissed as unnecessary or distracting, rose up from the depths of her. Things she pretended didn't matter, things she'd always believed she was better than, she knew with sudden clarity she desperately needed. Cold burned her body. Her eyes fluttered and closed. She toppled over, hitting the flagstones next to the creature with a heavy thump. A voice in her ear, in her mind, in her soul, soft and reassuring. A dream.
"Everything you want, I can give you. All you need, all you desire. What is it you crave? Respect, recognition, to be remembered. Let me help you. Are you not magnificent? Are you not exceptional? Who is this man to make demands of you? Petty he is. With his childish dreams of power, his wicked little mind, his pretense at intellect. Stand on your feet, lift your hands to his face, scratch and claw and bloody him. Take the necklace from him, give it to me, and in return, I will give you what you deserve, what you have always deserved. I will complete you. All you need to do is stand and...
The voice cut off, and with its end, she found she could think again, that her mind was her own. Neymar opened her eyes and rolled onto her back, dragging deep breaths of chilly air into her lungs. Joseph appeared in her vision, pale eyes watching her with curious, calculated interest.
What did it say to you? I couldn't hear.
Her head rolled to the side. The creature was prostrate next to her, unconscious. Black liquid oozed from its nose, and a heavy bruise was darkening its forehead, turning it from pale cornflower to midnight blue. Neymar turned away, closing her eyes. For the first time in almost 40 years, she wanted to cry. Amelia shifted from her dreams into the so-called real world with a jolt. The General Administration's rules for the running of successful plots state that no scene should begin with someone waking up. But then Amelia was human, and thus not privy to the strict rules governing story management, whereas she was keenly aware that something was wrong. The orrery was malfunctioning. She sat up in bed. The click-clack-clack of the cogs and the gentle lulling whirl of the planets had taken on a desperate edge, filling the observatory with a low scream of metal suffering. She stared, horrified, as the enormous device sped up, the planetary spheres spinning much too fast. The main axle would break, the rotor arms holding the planets would buckle, they would crash into each other. The gears would grind and shatter. 2 years of work lost in a moment. Jumping out of bed, Amelia ran across the observatory, grabbing her toolkit as she flew past it, her feet slipping on the cold stone floor. Then, as suddenly as it had begun, the malfunction ceased. The spheres slowed down, settling back into their normal speed, rotating in gentle circles around the main column, weaving in and out, over and above each other. Amelia caught her breath, which hung in clouds of condensation. She shivered. It was late autumn and the middle of the night, but should it be so cold? Her feet paled as she watched the orrery, counting quietly under her breath, checking each of the rotations. The orrery towered in front of her, beautiful in brass and iron, glass and crystal, wood and stone. The circular base took up almost half of the vast domed observatory provided to her by the Sisterhood of Cultivators. When all the planets were attached, it would probably fill the whole room. Amelia liked living with the sisters. They knew to leave her alone unless she requested something, and the orrery always needed something new. The larger it grew, the more complex the various components had to be to keep it working. It had taken her the past 2 years to work out the plans for a structure strong enough to support the planets. Not only the four she had already attached, but also the one she aimed to add in the future, as well as an engine that could power it. A tiny miscalculation in even the smallest cog or the length of a brace, even by the width of a sheet of paper, could ruin the whole thing in moments. And something had just gone wrong. Luckily, the orrery had righted itself, but sisters shouldn't be lucky. They had to be knowledgeable. Her counting finished, she darted into the orrery itself, ducking under the planets so she was standing at the base of the device, and checked the engine and the main shaft. All seemed in order. Next, she climbed the narrow ladder attached to the main shaft and, with painstaking precision, began checking each set of gears, rods, and connections. She had built small platforms encirculating the large central column, which allowed her to pause at various intersections to check the mechanics. Each platform was little more than a ledge, able to accommodate one person standing carefully. But, as she was the only one responsible for the orrery, they were perfectly serviceable. 2 hours later, and she was happy it was working. Once again outside the orrery, she stood back for one last visual check. The four spheres were turning correctly around the central column, each affixed to their own network of cogs and rotor arms, which jutted out at different heights and lengths, guiding them on their complex, intricate journeys. The middle sphere, one of the smaller ones, represented Tiana, the world Amelia called home. It spun now as it should, diving under and swooping over the others, all turning endlessly on their arcs, thanks to a steam engine of her own design, which recycled the wasted steam back into water. Of the four planets, by far the largest was the darkest sphere, which she had come to think of as the Black Planet. It had been the first one she completed, and it spun, glacial, on the highest arc, casting a shadow on the other three planets. She didn't know why she had built it first, nor why she had chosen to clad it in dark mahogany. She wasn't interested in aesthetics. It had seemed appropriate. So, why not? Amelia settled at her desk, opening one of her many notebooks. She felt a tingle in her chest, the flutter of a challenge waiting to be beaten. Working on the orrery was like trying to follow a rabbit through long grass, except that the rabbit was changing the landscape as it went. She could see its movements and occasionally glimpse a fluffy white tail. It was frustrating at times, but thrilling too. A task just for her, in a place of numbers and sums and puzzles. Somewhere she could hide, where no one would get hurt. Amelia bent over her notes, the sound of gears gentle and soothing. The malfunction, alarming as it had been, had also brought her something new. Another glimpse of the trickster rabbit, another route through the long grass. Why had it sped up? What had caused it? How had the various mechanisms been able to stand it, albeit briefly? What would happen when she was ready to add the next planet? She chewed on the end of her pencil. The paper waited, ready to be useful. Above her, the stars watched through the giant glass window in the domed, copper-plated roof, eager to see what she would uncover. Amelia frowned. The possibilities were clear in her mind, but she couldn't settle enough to concentrate on them. She spotted the problem. Barry was still in bed, his head resting on the pillow. She couldn't work without him. She padded back to the bed and poked Barry in his overstuffed belly. She didn't have to worry that she would annoy him. He never got cross with her, no matter how absorbed she became in her work, nor what strange hours she kept, nor if she didn't want to talk to him for hours or even days on end. She was, above all other things, her best friend. Barry fixed her with mismatched button eyes, his permanent smile telling her he didn't mind being woken up. Grabbing his paw, she carried the stuffed bear back to her desk and sat him on the tabletop by her notebook. Amelia was 12 years old, the kind of gangly that would one day be tall, with a heavy jaw, olive skin, and a thick mop of brown hair, all inherited from her father. The only thing she'd picked up from her mother, so the family joke went, was her know-it-all attitude. Amelia was also a genius, though she had no idea where that trait had come from, certainly neither of her parents. And though she didn't know it, she was less than a year away from destroying the world. Chapter 2. A hand rapped the desk, each knock sending Amelia's calculations flying from her mind. She looked up to see a pair of dark brown eyes, much like her own, except they were set in a face about 35 years older than hers, with warm, rich amber skin and framed by a cloud of neat, shiny black curls.
"You wanted to see me?" Neymar asked.
"Finally. I sent that message 30 minutes ago. The orrery malfunctioned last night. It's working again now, but I thought you'd probably want to know, you and..."
"Yes," Neymar interrupted, an odd tightness to her expression Amelia hadn't seen before.
"All right, I see."
Amelia shrugged.
"I don't mind if we don't tell him. I've got more important things to do. But he said that if anything important happened, I had to report it to him in person."
She waited, drumming her pencil against her notebook while Neymar considered. Why it was such a big deal, she had no idea. She had much better things to do than go traipsing across town. But she wanted Neymar to take her seriously, and apparently that meant she had to do pointless things as well as important ones. Finally, Neymar nodded.
"You're right. We'd better go."
She looked Amelia up and down. "You're still in your nightdress."
"Oh, right, yes. Well, I've been working."
Neymar went over to the narrow wardrobe by Amelia's equally narrow bed and rummaged through it, finally digging out a shirt with only 4 ink stains on it.
"So, what happened with the orrery?"
"The rotation sped up. The whole thing was moving too fast. I was worried the engine wouldn't hold up, but it didn't last very long before it went back to normal. I checked the orrery. It's all fine. I've been going over my notes since."
"Here we go. Get dressed, little princess,"
Neymar instructed, dropping the shirt and a pair of trousers on the desk.
"You don't know what caused it?"
"I'm not a princess," Amelia said, in the weary tones of one who'd made the point before. She took the bundle behind her dressing screen.
"I need to balance the revolutions, I think."
"That's easy. Adjust the ratios to reduce the rotation."
"It's not the gears. It's something else,"
Amelia replied as she pulled her trousers on. She stuck her head around the screen to look at the orrery, watching the spheres move around the central shaft, the gears turning them at different speeds. It should have been relaxing, like staring at fish in a pond. But it wasn't. There was something wrong. Amelia's gaze drifted to the black sphere. Maybe she'd miscalculated the weight and it had pulled too hard on the engine, speeding everything up. But when she checked, there hadn't been any sign of that.
"It should work,"
she said, lacing up her trousers. Dressed and ready to go, she rejoined Neymar.
"It does work. It just doesn't do what it should have done."
"Perhaps you need some help?"
"No. I'll work it out by myself."
"Ah, yes. I forgot what a clever little princess you are. How lucky we are to have you."
"I didn't mean it like that."
"And how did you mean it then?" Amelia glared at the floor.
"I just meant it's easier by myself. I understand all my notes,"
she muttered, not wanting the conversation to continue. Neymar, thankfully, seemed to feel the same way. "Perhaps the orrery's talking to you in a language you don't understand," she said, returning to the point. "Facts can't lie, but we can misunderstand." Amelia considered it. What Neymar was suggesting did make sense in a weird way. Could it be speaking to her in another language? But if that was the case, how could she learn it with no one to teach her? Language was slippery. Another tricksy rabbit darting here, there and everywhere.
"I got told off once," Amelia said. "When I was cold and we had some prince visiting, I told him to close the window. Mum said I shouldn't have said that. I should have asked him if he was cold. But I didn't really care if he was cold, and what if he wasn't? Then the window would have stayed open.
Politics can be like that.
What's politics got to do with it?
A pause. Nothing. Come on, it's time to go.
Securing Barry under her arm, Amelia allowed herself to be led out of the observatory and through the wide marble hallways of the main building. The cultivators resided in a purpose-built structure with rooms of different sizes and shapes to accommodate all the explorations in which they were engaged. The building had had a number of different names over the years, none of which interested Amelia, except the last. Castachisel, which meant Castle of the Stars. Starry Castle. She and Barry agreed it was the best name for the place, especially given their setup in the huge domed observatory with its shiny copper and glass roof. In fact, Starry Castle looked somewhat like the orrery. There was the rectangular central part of the building, and then the observatory rising up from the roof, like the troublesome black sphere. Around the main building, turrets, towers, conservatories and chambers butted out, each one built onto the primary structure when found to be necessary. Starry Castle wasn't really a castle, or at least not like the one Amelia had grown up in, which had been white with a massive drawbridge and thin turrets, topped with blue, pointy roofs, like upside-down ice cream cones. Amelia thought the castle she had grown up in was like an ice cream, decadent and overly sweet. Starry Castle was more purposeful. It was a busy place, with lots of other sisters, the youngest she'd spotted still at least a dozen years older than her, scurrying around with tasks to do and things to explore. She liked it here. Namer led Amelia to a side entrance, decorated with small statues of proud-looking women who, nearly 80 years earlier, had founded the Sisterhood of Cultivators and formalised the study of the world and its mysteries into the philosophy of Elementis. Or at least had formalised it in Eilidh, the Third Kingdom of Tyana. In fact, the philosophy of Elementis had begun much earlier, but that had been in Otaray, the First Kingdom, and therefore didn't count. Or at least not as far as the citizens of Eilidh were concerned. They made it out of Starry Castle and marched across the gardens, over the square patches of grass, through the gate. A coach was waiting, two large men standing by the door and a third on the driver's seat, holding the horse's reins. The big men held the door open. Namer stepped in first, Amelia following. She sat Barry next to her and looked out the window. They had maybe 30 minutes' travel through Cern Brelkstead before they would reach the Imperial Palace. A cold wind washed in from the bay and the air tasted of salt. Winter was coming and the nights were drawing in. But Cern Brelkstead was always slightly darker than it should have been. The city proper sat on the floor of a deep canyon, narrowing at one end to nothing, wide open at the other, onto the sea. They arrived at the bottom of a steep staircase running up the canyon wall, carved out of the very same rock. The destination was the huge palace above them, situated two-thirds of the way up the rock face, and extending deep into it. The people of Cern Brelkstead had learned how to make the most of their location. The wide bay provided them access to the shared sea and all the trade contingent on the same, while the canyon protected them from surprise attacks by neighbouring armies back when Eilidh had been prey to internal warfare. The canyon was only a few miles across at its widest point, where it opened out to the sea. But Cern Brelkstead had found another way to create space. They built into the cliffs, and the Imperial Palace was the grandest of such constructions. Namer had tried to explain the history of the place to her when she'd first arrived, but had thankfully given up. Civil engineering didn't interest Amelia. Still, she was somewhat grateful that someone found the subject rewarding, as they eschewed the long, steep staircase in favour of the trolley system. operated via large steam-powered rotational wheels, one on the ground and one up on the palace. The two trolleys hung from ropes as thick as oak trees. When one went up, the other went down. They were slow, laborious things, the wind seeping through their windows, ensuring anyone travelling in them got increasingly colder the higher they rose. But still, the trolleys were easier than walking, and as such were reserved only for the use of palace guests and dignitaries. Namer and Amelia made the rickety journey to the palace in silence. Amelia's mind drifted a little, thinking of ways to improve the terminal system so the trolleys didn't swing so much. They arrived safely, Namer nodding to the guards on the gate, and entered the palace, home to the man they were meeting. Joseph, brother to the Baron of the Imperial City of Cern Brulkstead. Chapter 3. Amelia pushed open the heavy door to Joseph's office, dragging Barry behind her, and left Namer waiting outside. Joseph was sitting at his desk, head bent over one of his little toy men, a paintbrush held between his thumb and forefinger. Amelia could feel his concentration even from the doorway. Walking quietly, not wanting to disturb something so precise, she approached the table and waited. While he put the finishing touches to the toy soldier's uniform, little yellow buttons on his blue coat, she allowed herself a moment to enjoy the silence. Joseph was like her, as far as she could tell. She didn't know him very well, certainly, but she recognised in him the same focus she had. Severe, her mother had called him once, citing his reputation and the way he stared at you until you spoke. It didn't bother Amelia, though. She was happy enough to stare back. The room smelled sharp and sweet. Amelia spotted a round metal vaporizer standing just behind Joseph. It created a strong smell of rotting onion and menthol, which was supposed to be good for one's recovery. But all it did was remind Amelia of doctors and priests, the type of people you only saw together when something had gone terribly wrong. She tried to breathe through her mouth. Other than the new addition of the vaporizer, she liked Joseph's office. It was neither too big nor too small, comfortably housing his workstation, his writing desk, the bookshelves, filled with children's storybooks Amelia had discovered to her disappointment, the globe under the window, and a barometer that stood as tall as a grandfather clock against the far wall. He even had a miniature orrery, just a little taller than she was, taking up the corner. He'd shown it to her the day she'd first come to Cern Brulkstead, explaining how the spheres represented all the known planets, including their own world, and how the clockwork and cogs could be used to mimic the way they moved around each other. He'd asked her what she thought of it. "Clumsy," she'd replied, bending to look between the spheres to the machinery behind them, the pillar of cogs moving with the tick, tick, tick of the simple wind-up engine. The orrery shuddered a little with each revolution, the clockwork running out of turns. "But it has potential to be elegant."
"Like the worlds it represents."
She'd straightened and looked at him, not sure if he was making fun of her. But Joseph had just waited for her to reply, his sharp eyes watching her as intently then as they were now focused on the toy soldier's uniform. "Yes," she'd said, "potentially."
"I'd like you to realise some of that potential for me,"
Joseph had replied. The next day, Amelia's possessions had arrived from home and she'd moved into Starry Castle.
"Apologies for keeping you waiting,"
Joseph said now, dipping his paintbrush into the little cup of water next to the toy soldier and carefully wiping the bristles with a cloth. He leaned back in his chair,
Wisps of grey smoke from the vaporizer encircled him. He had lost weight since she was last here. The veins on his hands and forearms like blue lines painted on thin parchment.
"How goes the task?"
he asked. Amelia tutted. "There was a problem last night." Joseph sat forward, disturbing the smoke.
"Last night? What time?"
"Probably around 3 or 4. I wasn't really thinking about it." Someone else might have wondered why Joseph asked about the time and not the problem, but Amelia was too distracted by the cloying scent of medicine. The smoke was nowhere near her, the vaporizer well calibrated to keep it around Joseph. But even so, she felt like her nose and throat were coated in the stuff.
"Interesting," Joseph said.
"And what exactly happened?"
"It started running too fast. Only for a moment. I checked everything, and it all appears to be functioning now, but..."
"But you're not sure what made it go wrong?"
Amelia tightened her grip on Barry. "No."
"There's something more," he said. It wasn't a question. "Tell me what it is."
Amelia dropped her gaze, concentrating on her fingers as they dug into Barry's fur. She wished suddenly that Namer was allowed into these meetings.
"It isn't doing what I thought it would do. It's not as straightforward as I'd imagined it would be. It's like it's trying to tell me something."
She would have sworn if her mother hadn't taught her not to. Why had she said that? It must have been thinking about Namer. Isn't that what she'd said earlier? But when Namer had said it, it had made more sense. Now, in this room with this thin, focused man, it sounded like one of the stories in his books. Joseph stared at her in that way that unsettled so many people, waiting for her to say more. He had a face like a hunting dog, a long nose and sharp cheekbones that pushed his features forward above a small, pursed mouth, and eyes that always seemed to be looking for something to chase. Maybe Joseph was a bit more like a wolf. Wolves ate tricksy little bunnies up, and people. Ate them all up. Amelia hugged Barry to her chest.
"When I came here, you said you wanted an orrery bigger and better than anyone had ever made before. Something complex and remarkable. A mixing of 2 of the 3 A's, astronomy and arithmetic. You said that I could make people happy."
"I remember," Joseph interrupted. "And I understood it was progressing well. Until last night, that is, when it reacted to something."
She had expected him to be annoyed, but instead he sounded thoughtful, questioning even. Like there was some obvious solution right in front of her and she wasn't seeing it. Reacted to what? There was nothing new in the observatory, nothing she hadn't requested or made specially. Amelia didn't know what he wanted to hear. He was sponsoring her place at Starry Castle. If she got it wrong, would he send her home? The scrape of wood against stone startled her. Joseph had stood and walked to one of the large shelves against the wall. He ran his cadaverous hand over his books, stopping when it landed on a small strongbox sitting on its own shelf. "No," Amelia corrected. "Not sitting. It was bolted onto the wood."
"Do you believe in magic, Amelia?"
"Of course not," she said, her anxiety momentarily forgotten in the sheer ridiculousness of his question. "I'm not a child."
Joseph glanced at Barry, but said nothing. Instead, he fished a key from his pocket, one of many connected to a key ring which was chained to his belt, and opened the strongbox, pulling out another key. Amelia watched with interest, loosening her grip on Barry.
Come with me,
Joseph instructed.
Where?
He didn't answer. Instead, he picked up his cane and exited his office, walking past Naima and down the corridor. She stared at him and then turned to Amelia.
Amelia?
Amelia met the confusion on Naima's face with her own, no doubt equally baffled, expression. She shrugged Barry under her arm and ran after Joseph. Keeping pace with Joseph was easier than with Naima. The man was in poor health, famously so. But even walking slowly, his cane sinking into the carpet, his breathing was long and thin, like someone trying to mask the fact they'd over-exercised. They walked through snaking corridors lit with oil lamps fixed to the walls. No sunlight ever entered the palace. Deep inside the canyon, there were no windows to allow it entry. The stone walls were smooth, sanded and polished to a fine degree. They looked beautiful, but even in that flickering lamplight, Amelia could see the sheen of damp on them. Expensive, thick, woven carpet lined the floors, an attempt to combat the perpetual cold emanating from the rock.
I'm going to show you something very rare, very special,
Joseph told her when they finally reached their destination, which was apparently a very heavy-looking door deep in the recesses of the palace. Joseph unlocked the door and pushed it open, leaning all of his skinny frame against it, and stepped inside. The room beyond was dark and smelled of old wood.
Come on,
Joseph called. Amelia hesitated. She didn't like the smell of wood any more than the smell from the vaporizer. But then, from inside the room, came the click of a tinderbox and the warm flare of an oil lamp, and then a wall lamp lit and another, chasing away the darkness. Inside was
a toy room,
Amelia asked, stepping through the doorway.
It's a collection,
Joseph said, his tone chilly. It was the closest she'd ever seen him to angry.
What's the difference?
Intelligence.
Oh.
Amelia looked around. The walls were covered in shelves that ran from floor to ceiling, each holding ranks of little wooden soldiers. Some of them were painted in colours she recognised, some not. There were soldiers from all over Eilidh, she was certain of that. The ones in red and gold looked like they were from Penqua, and the ones with the big curved swords had to be Otarian. There were hundreds of them, maybe thousands.
My father collects trophy heads, she said. He keeps them on the walls.
Any idiot can stab a spear into an animal.
You've met my father.
She hadn't meant to make a joke, but Joseph tittered, his hand coming up to hide his face. It was a funny gesture, like he was afraid of anyone seeing him smile. Still, she supposed no one was perfect. Even she couldn't help getting overwhelmed with thoughts and feelings, although she was getting better at hiding them away. The toys were interesting, but what really defined the room was the large table in the middle, covered with pretend towns and forests. At the top of the model country was a city, wedged inside a long, narrowing canyon which opened out into a wide bay, docks and marinas and jetties brushing against the sea. On the canyon walls near the bay was a structure built half in and half out of the rock. The side of the building, facing out from the canyon wall, was fronted with hundreds of windows in neat, regular lines, each one separated from its neighbour with tall, white columns. Leading up to it were stone steps. But even more fascinating were the little boxes running up the canyon wall on a string pulley system powered by a wind-up clockwork engine. It was not the only building that seemed to grow out of the canyon,
but it was by far the largest. I know what I'm looking at, Amelia realised. She searched the rest of the model of Cerne Brulkstead, and, sure enough, there was Starry Castle on the canyon floor. She could even make out the lines of metalwork between the panes of glass of her observatory, painstakingly painted onto the model. And there was the library and the various guild buildings, the bank and the hospital, and the tall houses they preferred to build here, all filling the space on the ground as it tapered to a narrow point at the canyon's end. Moving back to the bay, Amelia saw model boats and the sprawling shipyard that belonged to the O&P Shipping Company sitting squat by the docks. Her gaze travelled to a smaller, less ornate building. It was away from the rest of the docks, just beyond where the sea hit the cliffs. A jetty struck out into the water, allowing access to it. Otherwise, there was no visible way in. This building protruded less than the palace, almost like whoever had made it didn't want it to stand out too much from the cliff face. In the model, it had a wooden gate, but in real life, it was iron and stone, thick and heavy, to make sure no one could pass through it without permission. The entrance to the manufactories. The model was her home, rendered in tiny, intricate detail. Something was wrong, however. Everything inside the canyon seemed correct, but the land surrounding it, high above the city, was covered in buildings that didn't, couldn't, exist. Cerne Brulkstead's manufactories were kept underground, inside the canyon walls. As a result, long chimneys snaked through the earth, erupting in steam and smoke-filled stacks, making it impossible to build anything habitable on the plains above the canyon. And yet, there were little models dotted all over them. "This is Cerne Brulkstead," she said, leaning down to take in more detail. "But it's not accurate."
"Not yet," Joseph replied. "What else do you recognise?"
Amelia pursed her lips, wondering why they were wasting time on this instead of talking about the orrery, but did as he asked. She moved down what she now recognised to be the northern side of the table, away from the city. From west moving east, Cerne Brulkstead sprawled out further than in real life, but eventually petered out into empty plains, which then turned into farmsteads, little villages and small towns. Finally, her eyes came to a large, dense forest, which began not far in from the coast and stretched across the centre of the map. On the opposite side of the forest, near where Joseph stood, was another city and castle, this one with white towers and blue pointed turrets. Something pinched Amelia's stomach, almost like a stitch, but far sharper. She told herself the pain wasn't there and focused her attention back onto her side of the table. Here, the forest thinned to reveal a town much larger than the rest, with a heavy, old-fashioned castle in its centre. A few inches from this town, probably 5 or 6 miles in reality, was a smaller, oceanside town with little docks and simple stone buildings. She peered closer and saw that someone, Joseph clearly, had mixed sand in with the paint to achieve a more realistic effect. "It's Eilidh." She moved up to the table, back to the larger city, located in the northwest of the bean-shaped landmass. "This is Cerne Brulkstead. There's Scrack, and that's Clonotilly, and the docks at Sin."
"What do you know about Clonotilly?"
Joseph asked. Amelia thought back to her reading. "There was a coronation there not long ago. The last king had a heart attack, I think. His son's ruler now. It's an old kingdom, but poor. Farms, mostly, woods. They've got docks at Sin, but you've got a bigger bay here.
Is that all?
Roughly 60,000 people live there, with an average age of 40. General life expectancy is around 70, though that varies depending on career. The new king's name is John Edward Philip. He's uneducated. His father never sent him abroad to study. Clonotley has been losing money for a number of years, in part due to the irresponsibility of its past rulers, and in part due to the rise of modern machinery, like the steam engines. Cern Brockstead has taken away a lot of their trade, thanks to your investment in slavery and other modernisation techniques.
Anyone who can read would know that.
True, Amelia said, annoyed and beneath it, ever so slightly embarrassed. I've never really been that interested in geography or politics.
And I'm thankful for it, Joseph replied.
Moving around the table to stand next to her, he rested his fingertips on the model of Clonotley Castle.
Now, tell me what you know about magic.
He was staring at Clonotley Castle, pressing his fingertips so hard into the battlements they were turning white. This was definitely the strangest conversation she'd ever had. And so, faced with the bewildering sight of Joseph apparently trying to squish his own toy castle, she decided the best thing to do was to answer his demand as sensibly as she could.
Magic isn't real. But, I suppose if it were, it would probably be something we don't understand yet. If we were to travel back in time with one of the tractor's engines, for example, and show them to the farmers of the past, they would probably think they were magic. They wouldn't understand how steam can be used to power pistons, how cogs work, that kind of thing.
Joseph looked up.
Exactly. Now that we understand each other, I want to show you something.
Amelia wasn't entirely sure they did understand each other.
You didn't bring me here to show me the map.
No, no. Just a happy coincidence. A chance for you to show me what you know of the world. Now, I hope, Amelia, that you are prepared to be open-minded.
Amelia personally felt open minds were singularly useless. All the information fell out. A tight, strong mind was much better suited to grasping the mysteries of the world. But she'd come this far, and she wanted to know what he was talking about.
I'm prepared to learn, she said.
That should work just as well.
Joseph went to the corner of the room, where he unlocked a metal door that had been hidden in the dark. Behind it were shelves made of what looked like iron, holding yellowing scrolls, tools, and yet more strongboxes. Joseph selected a strongbox and brought it back to the table, straining with the effort. Amelia offered to help, but he grunted a refusal. He placed it on an empty part of the map and unlocked it with a key he'd removed from the very first strongbox back in his office. He lifted out a gold snake, curled like a horseshoe, but rounder and bigger. The snake's diamond-shaped head rested about 3 inches from the dagger tip of its tail. A hinge on the snake's back indicated that the gap could be widened. It was a necklace, Amelia realised. The metalwork was exquisite. Each of the tiny scales looked individual, and the piece flexed under Joseph's grip, enabling the widening of the gap to fit around a person's neck. He held the snake out to Amelia. When she touched it, the metal was colder than she expected, given the heat of the room. It tingled against her fingers, reminiscent of the sensation of wool worn too long. The snake wasn't heavy, and there looked to be some tarnish around the hinge.
Where did you get this?
Amelia asked.
It was a gift.
Who from?
A friend. Tell me what else you think about it.
Joseph said, I'd like your insight.
I'm not sure what else I can say without taking it away and studying it. I don't think it's gold, and it isn't plate. Copper doesn't shine like that. You should ask Naima. Not that I couldn't tell you more.
Amelia quickly amended.
It's just she's more interested in rocks and minerals than I am.
No, absolutely not.
Why not?
Joseph waved the question away.
It's a secret. I want to give you a piece of it to use in the orrery. You know what Namer's like. Everything has to be written down.
That was true. Amelia certainly found the endless reports and note-taking very annoying. Still, she didn't like the idea of keeping a secret.
I can get metal from the sisters.
Not like this. Don't you want to make the orrery better?
Yes, of course, but it sounds like you think this necklace is magic. I thought you had something real to help me with.
Joseph caught her in his wolf stare.
And I thought we had just agreed magic is something we don't understand yet. Now, over there, you'll find a hot iron. I use it for the model. You know how to work one?
Of course, but...
He handed her the snake.
Think of it as an experiment. I'll wait outside until you're finished. The heat, you see. It upsets me.
Amelia was about to ask why he had a hot iron if he didn't like the heat, but thought better of it. He did look tired, his skin clammy. People were always saying he was sick, weren't they? She felt a twinge of guilt for arguing with him. What difference did it make anyway? She might as well humour him. Besides, the quicker all this was done with, the quicker she'd be back in Starry Castle.
All right, she said.
Take a piece from the tail, not the head. Don't damage the hinge.
He instructed before closing the heavy door behind him. It was much harder going than she'd expected. Once the iron, heated in a special oven, was glowing white, it should have cut through the soft metal like butter. Instead, after more than an hour of effort, having to stick the iron back into the oven more than once, Amelia was sweaty, extremely irritated, and had only succeeded in shaving off half an inch from the tail. She dumped the iron in the waiting bucket of water, a cloud of steam rising up, unwelcome against her already sticky skin. She wiped her face with a thick glove she'd put on and returned the necklace. The little bit of tail sat separately from the body. And then it twitched. Amelia didn't gasp, but she did lean closer. The tail twitched again, this time jumping towards the snake proper. She picked it up in her gloved hands, and it stopped moving. It must have been the heat causing the metal to expand and move. She went to the door and pulled it open with her free hand. Joseph was sitting neatly on a bench, waiting.
Done,
he said.
It worked.
Yes. What now?
He smiled at her from behind his hand.
Now, you're going to melt that down, make a cog or screw or whatever you like from it. And you're going to use that in the orrery. I hope you're not in a hurry to get anywhere.
Chapter 4. Preparing oneself to feel pain is rarely a pleasant experience. Will it be as bad as you expect, or are you simply exaggerating the problem? How many times, for example, does the dentist have to reassure the client that the pain of removing a tooth is better than the agony of letting it rot? Some things become bearable simply because we learn to live with them.
And sometimes, even when we know it will hurt, we try again anyway. Seven, the last surviving genie, closed his eyes, his hands balled up in fists, shoulders tight. He took a deep breath and pictured a cave in a forest far away, layering the memory piece upon piece until he could almost taste the chill air and smell the soft, mossy ground. He pictured his bed, made by his own hands. It had been unvarnished, barked, and more than a little rustic, but it had also been safe and comfortable and, most importantly, secret. Just like the cave. When the image was crystallized in his mind, he pulled on his magic and pushed himself towards the cave, praying that the force would transport him to the safety of his hidden home. The magic attacked, sharp teeth tearing at his flesh, layer by layer, scraping and scratching, fraying, flaying, pulling him apart. And behind it, as always, the heavy, hazy thrill of pleasure. The clarity of thought, the purity of it, that only the bliss of agony could offer. All too quickly it passed, the magic leaving his body as swiftly and violently as it had entered. He fell to the floor, spent, spurned, spoiled. For some time he lay there, curled in on himself, his breath ragged. When the torment of the magic, the pleasure and the pain of it finally waned, he clambered to his feet, wiping black blood from his face with the back of his pale blue hand. And then he tried again to remove himself from the tower. 4 days were spent like this before Seven finally gave up. In truth, he didn't really know why he tried even once. Joseph had spoken very clearly. "I wish you unable to travel beyond this room by any means without my express permission." But Seven had been unwilling to accept that his cunning was no match for the simplicity of the wish, so he'd raged against it, poking and pulling it apart for some weakness, when he knew objectively that there was none. And so, towards the end of his first week imprisoned, he'd had to accept that there was, no escaping the facts. He was trapped in a tower that bulged half in and half out of a sheer cliff, without his necklace, at the mercy of yet another person who thought they somehow deserved to get everything they'd ever wanted. Clearly, Joseph was no fool. The wish was tight, the wording too direct to be twisted. But even if it weren't, the cost of trying to perform any magic without the safety of his necklace was a high one. Once Seven's anger and humiliation eased, he began to think more clearly about his situation. Even if he had been able to transport himself out of the tower, he'd have arrived back in his cave, a broken thing, poisoned by the magic used to make the journey. Without his necklace, he was extraordinarily vulnerable. And how long, exactly, could he survive without it? He was already feeling the effects of its absence, a dull ache behind his eyes, a queasiness in his stomach. He needed his necklace first, and then he could turn his attention to Joseph. Seven always got to the root of a person, pulling the truth out of them, devastating them to the point where all they wanted was to be free of him. All the petty things they'd craved, which they'd never admit to, were worked loose by Seven, revealing them in a way no person wanted to be revealed. Such people very rarely made a second wish. Or, in the rare occasions when such strategy failed, Seven was often able to subvert the wish, to get it over with quickly, so that the magic had little chance to work its poison on him. Take the infamous pickle wish. Seven had managed to both reveal the man's vanity and give him precisely what he'd asked for, though not at all what he'd wanted. Gods, the look on his face when he'd realised what Seven had endowed him with. The memory cheered Seven enormously. Sooner or later, greed would get the better of Joseph, and he'd be back for his second and third wishes. Then he'd make a mistake, as humans always did, and Seven would have him. For now, it seemed, he had no choice but to wait. At least the tower was well appointed, with a wide bed, a sofa, a writing desk stocked with paper, chalk and charcoal, and a small mirrorless room which housed a stone drop toilet above a pit, and a tap covered in hard limescale that dribbled icy cold water when turned. There was also a little bookshelf filled with nursery stories about fairies and elves, beautiful maidens and handsome men. A joke, Seven supposed, though not a particularly funny one, much like the unlocked door. During the second week, a young woman came with food and a bucket of warm, soapy water. Seven made good use of all three, washing the sweat and blood from his body before gorging himself on the food, and then, when he felt more like himself again, turning his attention to the woman. He picked up her hand and examined it. He saw the surprise on her face and shot her a shy smile, carefully crafted. An old trick, boring almost, but useful when it landed. It took him less than an hour to unravel her, opening her up to experiences she'd always wanted but been too repressed to explore. It was luck, really, that someone so ready to be tempted had been sent to him. Seven had done many terrible things in his life, but there were lines he'd never crossed. She promised to sneak him in a kitchen knife when she next brought food. When Joseph came, Seven would be ready. But she didn't arrive the next day, or the next, or the next. At the beginning of his third week of incarceration, Seven was sent a man in his mid-30s who looked to be some kind of clerk. He arrived as the young woman before him had, only this time without the bucket. A lesson, Seven was informed, though it seemed the clerk hadn't been told what the lesson was supposed to teach. He was starving, but Seven realised instantly that this man would not respond well to weakness. So he greeted him warmly, offered him some of his food, and asked about the woman.
"Sent to the manufactories," the clerk said with a sniff. "Don't know why, but it must have been serious."
Seven paused, a grape halfway to his lips.
"I have heard tell of these places. Very few survive them." "It's the price of progress. Besides, we only send our own down there when they deserve it."
"Is that so? My understanding is you populate these manufactories with slaves. I wonder, my friend, that you can stand such a thing. You are a progressive, are you not? A man of thoughts and ideas, not to be shackled by such barbarous actions."
The clerk preened, pleased with the description, as Seven had suspected he would be.
"I can tell a man of substance," Seven said, pressing home his advantage. "A man destined for great things. Clearly you are no simple lackey. Your bearing, your intellect, inform me this cannot be."
"Well, yes. Actually, I work directly for his lordship, the Baron."
"I am unsurprised to hear it. Indeed, if I may speak truthfully, I am most surprised that you serve. I would have thought you better suited to be master."
Pulling out the clerk's fantasy was easier than the servant's. Sex, in Seven's experience, was a prize hard won,
People were, for reasons he couldn't fathom, much more cautious when it came to consenting to an act that was really little more than physical necessity. When it came to their ambitions, however, they were much more willing to be serviced. The clerk left, his mind alight with a promise of power, vowing to return with Seven's necklace. He never came back either. The visit stopped. The door was locked, and a small hatch cut into the wood. The lock was not for Seven, but to stop people coming in should he try to tempt them, which of course he would have done, if it had been a possibility. Food was delivered cautiously, quickly, quietly, and infrequently. Seven was alone, trapped in the tower with only the steadily increasing pain of his missing necklace for company. It occurred to him after the third month, in a way it hadn't before, that he could very well die here. Chapter 5. Management was a thankless task, even before trying to do it well, and Naima found herself in the unenviable position of being both responsible for all the cultivators at Castach Yersel and also having to justify their existence to the population. The cultivators cost money, funding which came from the public purse, and the public, by and large, were losing interest in knowledge for knowledge's sake. It wasn't that the cultivators weren't respected. In a general sense, people understood that many of the advancements they enjoyed were a result of the sisters' work. But equally, the public were also put off by their tendency to make things explode or change colour or melt. Every now and again, Naima's memory would randomly throw up the image of Celia's face just before she turned into a puddle of bubbling toxic foam. That incident had done nothing, unsurprisingly, to ingratiate the cultivators to the public. Not only that, but with the rise in steam power and the success of international companies like the Oteray and Penqua Shipping Concern, the famous O&P, and dubious benefit of the manufactories, a lot of people simply didn't appreciate funding what they saw as proving the bleeding obvious, or, more damningly, as sexist and elitist due to their strict admissions policy. Naima had plans, though. The sisterhood could be what it once was. No, it could be better. With funding, she could open a boys' college. Small at first, naturally, but it would be a step towards parity. She even had designs on the manufactories. Technology could revolutionise the work that went on within those cold stone walls, minimise deaths, maybe even remove the need for the slaves completely. There was so much that could be done, but tradition was a heavy metaphorical rock to reposition, and so far, Naima had barely managed to shift it an inch. And now, there was Joseph to contend with, and the repercussions of his acquisition in the tower. Two such repercussions were currently standing in front of her, having recently filed their preliminary report on their experiences at a royal ball held in the small kingdom of Clonotley, some 30 miles east. The report was late, due to the fact the two sisters had spent 3 months in hospital recovering. Naima spun a curl of hair on her finger as she studied their report. It was easier than having to look at the two younger women standing in front of her desk, one of whom was leaning on a crutch. She'd heard the expression, holding the tiger by its tail, but had never quite understood its meaning until now. Folding her hands on top of the report, she looked up. "So, you're claiming that a monster attacked the ball," Naima said, pointlessly hoping that somehow the sisters' report might change on the third telling. A silent conversation occurred between the two women, an intricate pattern of raised eyebrows, pursed lips, darting eyeballs and, at one point,
a slight bobbing of the head. Name awaited.
Yes, sister.
The one without the crutch replied at last. She had warm khaki-brown skin, her hands and forearms covered in thin white scars, like she'd been attacked by a psychopathic pincushion.
I can't think of another way to describe it. I have tried to.
The scarred cultivator continued.
We were in the ballroom, observing the guests and making some minor anthropological notes, when the glass doors exploded inward, and suddenly there was this huge monster in the room, attacking the guests, picking people up and throwing them against the walls. I'm certain it killed the king.
Can you describe this monster?
Yes, absolutely.
She pulled a thick, well-thumbed notebook from one of her many pockets and opened it at a marked page. The tension in her voice eased as she settled into reading her observations.
It was approximately 15 foot tall and extremely strong, even allowing for its immense size. It was humanoid in appearance, though the creature's head was smaller on its body than I would expect a person's to be. And it had rounded eyes, rather like a frog's, though set like ours in the face. It was also intelligent.
Naima's heart sank.
Thank God for her upbringing, which had given her training in putting on a blank face when she needed to.
What makes you think that? The creature's human-like appearance?
No, sister. I'm basing my conclusion on the fact that it could speak. We know because the other, monster spoke to it.
Silence. So intense that had anyone bothered to drop a pin, it would have rung out like the palace bells at noon. Naima looked down again at the report, not yet officially entered into the records. She needed to nip this in the bud, and the best way to do that was to treat it like any other mistaken experiment.
This would be the blue man, I suppose? Yes, said the scarred cultivator. Blue like I am brown, she is white and you are black.
No one is blue, sisters, Naima said, making sure she sounded like she believed what she was saying.
You must have made a mistake. Understandable, of course, given the circumstance you describe.
A giant man is feasible, if allowed the right conditions growing up. Strong, too. And animals might have been trained to attack, explaining the little creatures that hurt you. But a blue man... Have you ever heard of any such race of people?
The two women shook their heads.
I'm pleased to see your good sense hasn't left you, Naima said, ignoring the sting of her conscience. Happily, her growing anger made it easier. Facts were facts, and here she was having to make her sisters believe they had imagined something.
Naima drummed her fingers on her desk. The two women waited.
Nothing ever happened quickly in Castech Yassel,
especially thinking.
Eventually, she said, I can understand how the trauma of an attack can rattle a person. The mind plays tricks. The psycharium is full of such people. I think... Given your injuries and the stress you've no doubt been under, it would be better if I kept this report and you reflected on what it is you think happened. The cultivators are under a lot of external pressure, as you know. We need to maintain our reputation for factual exploration.
The two women shared another look,
clearly aware Namer had just cast aspersions on their sanity. But aloud, the scarred one said,
"Yes, sister."
"Good," Namer said. "Off you go." The two women exited. Namer marched over to her window overlooking the bay. Her skin itched. Her dishonesty as irritating as flea bites. If only she could dig a hole, fill it with herbs, and be rid of the feeling as easily as dealing with such pests. What could she do? She'd made the agreement now. Joseph wasn't the kind of person to let one off the hook, and that was before he'd got his hands on that thing in the tower. She should have known his offer was too good to be true, the funding and support he promised too generous, that the terms, when first given to her, were too easy. Hell, not just easy, tempting. He'd offered her the chance to reinvigorate the cultivators, to open up the sisterhood, to change the world. Or to change Cern Brulkstead, which was near enough the same thing, given the city's influence. To be remembered. If Namer had been inclined, she would have wished she'd never accepted Joseph's original invitation to discuss the future of Castechia Cell. Unfortunately, she was now all too aware of the danger of wishes. Next on Namer's list of difficult duties was a trip to the observatory. It had been a month since she'd last paid a personal visit, though she had kept up with Amelia's hastily written updates. What greeted her when she stepped through the heavy observatory door was, however, beyond anything she'd expected. The orrery had doubled in size since she'd last seen it, and then it had not been small. It now had 5 planets, all spinning in perfect harmony. A gentle, intoxicating rhythm that lulled the soul. It had always been relaxing to watch the spheres moving, but now it was something beyond that, as if the device were an old friend reaching out to her, soothing away the stresses and anxieties of the day. There was something just so correct about it. A memory stirred of when she'd been younger, newly arrived at Castechia Cell, and had just seen the alchemy chambers and the geological catalogues. The moment Namer had realised that she was home, in a way that the barracks, for all its many rooms and distractions, had never been home. The orrery made her feel the same way now as she had then, that she was in a place that made sense, and where sense was made. "You like it?" Amelia asked, appearing from behind the orrery. She was covered in muck. "It's very impressive. You learned how to understand what it was saying then?" "Yes, I suppose I must have done," Amelia said, grinning in a very smug fashion. Namer did not appreciate the vagueness. "Have you been keeping records, at least?" "Most of the time. I keep forgetting. My notebooks are on my desk if you want to check." Biting back a sharp reply, Namer moved over to Amelia's desk and thumbed through one of her notebooks. She was relieved to see that there were, in fact, pages of detailed notes and equations, albeit somewhat haphazardly organised. Engineering wasn't Namer's field, but she knew some of the basics.
"You designed a new component?"
"More than one, in fact." Amelia's voice sounded hollow. She was inside the orrery. Namer could catch glimpses of her between the rotating globes.
"Speaking of which, can you pass me that, what's it? No, on your right. Yes, that one. I need to adjust the speed on this planet. It's not meant to move nearly so slowly."
"I thought going too fast was the problem."
"I fixed that."
"And how did you decide how fast they're meant to move?"
Namer asked, passing the what's it through a gap in the rotation.
"You mapped the stars?"
"Yes,"
came the muffled reply. It was surprisingly dark at the centre of the device, the large black orb at the highest elevation casting a long shadow.
I am in an observatory.
Namer suppressed a smile despite herself. Very true. It's not an exact process, though, or so I understood.
It wasn't. I worked it out. I did say you could look at my notebooks.
She debated going back to the desk and really looking through Amelia's notebooks, but not for long. There was something so restful about the orrery. Strange, really. They weren't particularly interesting devices. Certainly not something she would have thought about spending any time on. Most people could make one if they had the tools. Garden shared elementis, hardly worthy of a cultivator's time. And yet, the orrery Amelia was constructing was unlike anything she had seen before. It really is a marvel, Namer said. You should be proud. There was a thunk, and then one of the globes began moving slightly faster on its axis, only by a little. But the change managed to make the whole thing even more satisfying. That's good, Namer said over the whirl of cogs and machinery. Much better. It was like the orrery was even more itself now, like watching a fawn grow into a stag, a process so natural, so wonderfully inevitable. It satisfied some deep-rooted expectations she didn't even know she'd had. Amelia's head popped up from behind the spinning globes.
You'd better stand back.
Oh, what?
Stand back.
There was a pause of one rotation, and then Amelia made the jump between the spheres, landing with a tumble on the floor where Namer had been standing. She stood up and wiped herself down.
Was there something you wanted?
Oh, yes. With some regret, Namer followed Amelia to her desk. I assume you've written to Joseph with your progress. Amelia frowned.
He doesn't want to see me.
He hasn't asked to.
Oh, well, all right. I'll write something up for him later.
It was Namer's turn to frown. The orrery was spectacular, certainly, but that didn't mean that the girl could ignore her other responsibilities. Write it now. You know how we work here, little princess. If you want to be a sister, you've got to behave like one. It seemed for a moment that Amelia would refuse. But then she plopped down onto her chair and began scrawling out an update on the first piece of blank paper she came across. Now that the difficult work is finished, perhaps you can turn your skills to some of the other projects we're working on. Namer said as she wrote, There are some interesting discoveries being made in the...
Oh, no, I don't think I'll be finished for a long time, Amelia announced, head bent over her begrudging report. In fact, I'd like you to write to my mum, my parents, that is, and let them know I won't be back until next year at the earliest. I know I was supposed to go home by winter's night, but the orrery needs me, and Joseph wants it finished, so...
The implication hung in the air. Politics was not the realm of the cultivators, but the arrangement that had been brokered between Joseph and Amelia's parents was clear. 2 years, and the girl went home. Don't you miss your family? She asked.
No.
Scribble, scribble. Namer should have expected that answer. She had a pile of unopened letters in her office from Amelia's mother. At first, the girl had read them and replied. But as the months drifted into years, she'd stopped. Eventually, Namer had given up delivering the letters. Instead, she kept them, still sealed in her office, waiting for the day Amelia might want to read them. I expect they miss you, Namer said, trying a different track. You've been gone such a long time.
Maybe.
Scribble, scribble.
I dunno.
Scribble, scribble.
Probably not.
Amelia folded the paper, sealed it with a blob of wax, and handed it over.
Here.
I'm not your servant, little princess.
Well, I can't take it. I've got too much to do.
The two women glared at each other for a moment, and the Namer took the report.
How much longer do you want to keep working on the orrery, then?
Perhaps you can stay until Diurnod or Ola.
Amelia spun around in her chair to look at her creation.
That's the candle festival, right, for the end of winter? That won't give me enough time either. I keep getting new ideas about how to improve it. Now I've got the basics pinned down, I'm finally getting somewhere.
Well, I suppose that's what we want, really. Namer found herself saying, improvements.
I'll see what his lordship has to say. It's not as simple as just writing to your parents, you know that.
Amelia sighed.
Yes, I know. But I want to stay.
She sounded suddenly very young and small.
I don't want to go home. Please don't make me.
Namer reached out and patted the girl's shoulder. Behind them, Barry the bear sat on the bed, his glass eyes fixed on the orrery. It would have been difficult in that moment to say which set of eyes was more transfixed. Chapter 6. Joseph was sitting in the garden, wrapped under a blanket with a thick scarf around his neck, reading. Surely it was too cold for such a thing. The palace garden was in fact a landscaped balcony jutting out of the canyon wall. They might not get snow in Cernbrulkstead, but this high up a bitter breeze, unconcerned with sovereignty, travelled straight across the land bridge from the neighbouring country of Vorias. Nevertheless, Joseph seemed restful, the only indications of his ill health being the cane resting against his chair and a large jug of thick green liquid he was slowly working his way through. Namer only vaguely knew what was wrong with him, some wasting sickness he'd had since childhood. It came and went in bouts, often confining him to his bed, doctors from the best hospitals in Cernbrulkstead hovering around him. They'd yet to find a cure. Still, he was luckier than most. There was a tradition in Cernbrulkstead, especially amongst the gentry, of abandoning sickly children to the sea. Anthropology wasn't Namer's particular interest, but from what she understood, it all centred around the fact that so much of the lives of the well-to-do were conducted inside the walls of the canyon. If a child was born too weak for the cold and dampness of life within the rocks, then a quick end in the waves awaited. Apparently it had been Joseph's mother, the late Baroness, who had saved him from that fate. It was Joseph's illness that had first brought Namer to his attention, in fact. The cultivator's purpose was research, and part of her campaign to re-enfranchise them had centred around the benefit their work might have to areas outside of their traditional remit, such as medicine. But the medical colleagues preferred to do things their own way, and with a ready supply of slaves for them to practice on, it had been next to impossible for Namer to convince anyone that the cultivators might also have something to offer. But Joseph had been surprisingly receptive. At the time, she'd put it down to the desperation of the sick. He had, however, taken a keen interest in all their work, especially engineering, astronomy, and history. He'd asked about children's stories too, and had been disappointed when she'd said they didn't study such things. She glanced up at the tower where the creature was kept. In hindsight, the warnings about Joseph's true focus had been there from the beginning. But who would have ever believed such a thing was possible?
Namer, good afternoon.
She didn't jump, though she had to fight the urge. She'd swear his eyes hadn't left the page.
Good afternoon, my lord. Apologies, I thought you were reading.
He closed the book and looked up at her, his eyes narrowed against the bright, early winter sun.
I was.
Oh, a good book, my lord. He held it for her to read the title. Predictably, it was yet another collection of children's stories. The book was very old, the spine fraying at the edges, and the picture on the front little more than a pale silhouette. She tried to read the author's name, but it had faded to only a few letters. Joseph was watching her reaction closely. She handed him Amelia's hastily written report. If he found it too brief, nothing showed on his face, though he did cover his mouth with his hand at one point. When he was finished, he folded the paper up and tucked it in his pocket. Namer would have left then if she could. Unfortunately, there was more to be discussed. She just wasn't sure how to approach it.
"She's made a lot of progress, my lord," Namer offered.
"She has."
"And you're pleased?"
"Certainly."
"Ah, good. She's working very hard. You never did explain why you wanted her to build it, nor why you want that thing in the palace," she added, hoping he might pick up the conversation. Joseph sat quietly, watching her with eyes that didn't seem to blink. She tried unsuccessfully not to think about how creepy he was. "It's the way he looks at people," Namer thought, as she tried to maintain eye contact. "He was always studying you, scanning your features for clues, waiting to see what you would do or say. It wasn't just that his staring was rude. It tripped over into something else. She could imagine the same intensity in a child faced with a stranger trying to work them out. While she might find a toddler's scrutiny mildly annoying, in an adult it was downright disturbing. Her father had had an infantry man executed once. She'd asked him what the criminal had done, but he'd refused to explain. She knew now, of course. War made people do terrible things, certainly. But there were some who needed little convincing, and once the battle was done, they found they had developed a taste for bloodshed. That man had liked watching people too. Namer held on to the silence for as long as she could bear, but Joseph was always going to win any conversational tug of war. "Well, I'm pleased that you're pleased, my lord," she said, giving up. "However, there may be an issue."
"Surely not."
"She wishes to keep working on it, to extend her stay."
"Is that a problem?"
Namer found herself falling into the pose she used to adopt when she was receiving some accolade or another as a child, a stance called at ease, though it rarely was.
"What about her family, my lord?"
"What about them?"
"I understood the girl was only to remain with us for 2 years."
"Do you need more funding? You know I can always speak with my brother about your finances."
Namer paused.
"No, my lord, thank you. The palace is very generous."
"Well then," he said, picking up his book, "I see no problem with her extending her visit. Do you?"
"No, my lord."
It would have been a relief to send Amelia home for a few months. The letters from her mother were growing increasingly frequent, and as the pile rose, unopened in her office, so did Namer's guilt at keeping Amelia. Not that the girl wasn't bright. She'd make a good cultivator one day. But she was too young and too focused, obsessed, in fact, on the orrery. It wasn't healthy. And that was without the nagging unease that Joseph's interest in her work elicited. The man in question had returned to reading his book as if she wasn't there. Namer coughed.
"Will you inform her parents?"
"If you need my help, I'm happy to give it,"
he replied, closing the book in a way she thought was rather pointed.
"Is that all? Or do you have any other issues you need me for?"
"Actually, yes, my lord.
One more thing. If she's going to stay, the orrery takes up a lot of her time, too much. She caught the accusation in her tone and swallowed it. She's missing classes, her biology, geology, anthropology. She glanced at his book. Folklore, any subject that isn't related to engineering or astronomy, is suffering.
I thought the cultivators encouraged specialization.
Yes, my lord, but only when one has a solid foundation in all the major subjects.
And you consider folklore to be a major subject? Your expression just now didn't suggest that, even knowing what you know.
I don't believe we should privilege any one type of knowledge over another, my lord.
A little bit of knowledge is a dangerous thing, though. Isn't that what they say?
Joseph replied.
Perhaps it would be better to have her focused on one task.
That wasn't the right meaning of the quote, but Namer didn't correct him. Instead, she said, "A good foundation in all the subjects is beneficial, my lord. It helps us to see things from different points of view, to solve problems."
All the more reason for her to stay, then.
Joseph parried,
"Let her catch up."
Namer gave up. "Yes, my lord."
"While you're here, Namer, I have a question for you. I've been thinking about our guest, the one in the tower."
He clarified unnecessarily.
"Tell me, have you ever thought about absolutes?"
"The philosophy of Alimentus teaches us that there are truths to be found, my lord," Namer said, falling back on the blessed structure of the cultivators rather than acknowledge the sickly heat in her stomach at the mention of the blue-skinned creature. "But I can't say whether they are absolute."
"But some things are fundamentally true, are they not? Pain is always painful. Happiness is always happy."
"I suppose so, my lord, but people experience them differently." He tapped his book against his chin.
"Ah, yes, true. Still, it's something to think on. Perhaps when I'm in a position to help you open your boys' college, you might permit me to guest lecture on the subject."
"Of course, my lord. It would be an honour."
"Excellent, Namer. Thank you."
And that was that. Joseph opened his book again and started reading. For a moment, she didn't know what she was supposed to do, a decidedly unpleasant and increasingly more frequent feeling. Her brain thankfully came back to her. Namer bowed and left him in the garden reading his book of children's stories as the cold night drew in over the bay, pulling the winter behind it. An hour or so later, Joseph closed his book. He'd read it many times over and plenty more like it. Naturally, the stories differed. Time changed them, as did the personal interests of the author. A lot of them appeared to be based on oral histories and folk tales, adapted slightly for whatever the current fashion was when they'd been written. But there was a seam of truth to be mined, if you read carefully enough. And everything he'd read had been corroborated one way or another. He wasn't just relying on the literature, as the cultivators would say. Words were important, that much was obvious. He'd worked that out as a child, stuck in his room with only his stories for company. Almost every genie tale had someone being caught out by the words they used. He'd been careful so far, and so far he was winning. It had been interesting, nevertheless, to see how the genie had tried to break free. To watch its famed manipulation in action as it attempted to convince his people to turn on him.
If anything, Joseph had been rather disappointed. The genie's tactics had been obvious, dull, clumsy even, especially where Namer was concerned. Though, to give credit where it was due, he could allow for the fact the genie hadn't been at its best when it had tried to get Namer to kill him, and both the scullery maid and the clerk had been absolutely determined to carry out the genie's instructions. If Joseph hadn't been waiting safely outside the door with some palace guards to capture them and dump them in the manufactories, they might even have succeeded. Of course, he'd also taken risks. Every hero had to face trials, after all. Having Amelia break the necklace had been his most recent gamble, but he'd made sure he was safely behind a heavy door when she'd done it. And from the report tucked in his pocket, it seemed like his plan had worked perfectly. Was working perfectly. In truth, he hadn't anticipated the Orrery reacting to the genie's necklace so quickly. It was so tempting to try to rush things along, but he knew he had to hold his nerve. Temptation was the surefire way to lose the upper hand when dealing with a genie. Naturally, with two wishes left, he had thought about skipping ahead, dumping Amelia, wishing the Orrery complete, and using his final wish to fulfil his destiny. But Joseph was smarter than that. There was too much space in a wish like that for the genie to find cracks, to break it open. The other constant in all the stories were the limitations. Three wishes, no more. And the genie and its lamp, or as he'd learned, necklace, had to be together. It seemed a design flaw, but then design flaws were an inherent aspect of the genie's condition. The magic clearly hurt it, for all the rumours that it also brought pleasure. The servants Joseph sent infrequently to drop food off to the genie, with strict instructions not to speak, enter the room or dally, told tales of sickness and the stench of blood. The genie, it seemed, suffered an illness just like him. But that was the trouble when things were left up to nature, Joseph thought, reaching for his disgusting green medicine. So much was poorly put together. But not for much longer. Just until he worked out the perfect wording for his second wish. And if it was as strong as he suspected it would be, he'd never need his third one. Soon, he'd have everything he could ever wish for, and he'd still have the genie. That was the beauty of his plan, and why he could stand to wait. He was so close. When it all worked out as it surely would, he'd be a hero, a saviour. The man who made Cernbrulkstead the greatest city in all of the Third Kingdom, hell, in all five kingdoms of Tyana. And unlike all those idiots in the stories, he wouldn't be caught out by the genie's tricks. His time was coming. There is a saying that even a broken clock can tell the time twice a day. It's true, of course. And yes, the time may well be correct for those brief hours, but it's wrong the other 22. Broken clocks can fool you into thinking they aren't, if you don't pay attention to them. And no one really paid Joseph any attention at all. Chapter 7. Seven lay on his bed, cornflower blue fingers pressed to his temples as if the pressure would ease the pain. It didn't. 6 months had passed without his necklace, and his head was in constant torment. Food was shoved irregularly through the hatch in his door, and what was given to him was meagre fare. Hard bread, apples, bowls of gruel, If Seven had been human, he probably would have starved. The door remained locked, and those charged with bringing him his meals never tarried. Or so it had been until today.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.